What's happening, troops? It's Billy here from the SWN podcast. So I've got a very special episode for you. You know what the episode is because you can read the title. But I'm joined on this occasion, episode 193, by the Fresh Prince of the Moines Square. Say that five times. Himself is Ravie Davie. Welcome to the show.
What's happening, troops? I need to know what your catchphrase is so I can steal that as well.
None.
I know, thank you for having me on. I look forward to doing it. It's been long overdue. I actually had forgot you'd asked me ages ago, so I'd actually thought you'd never asked me before. So I was that way when I got asked to go on, I was buzzing. Not because it is quite, well, I'm very busy, and I hate saying that because obviously it sounds like I'm trying to boast about having a lot today, because it sounds like I'm complaining, but I'm not. I enjoy being busy, you know what I mean? But it's just because it's been raining the day and that as well, and it's not got to change. I usually go out flying for upcoming shows and stuff like that, but Drumchapel's got like two tickets left, so I've no fear of that's not going to sell it. Drumchapel this Friday, so I don't feel that that's not got to sell it, so I could maybe take the day after that, so I thought, and I just said to you, get me on, and you've managed to accommodate me, so that's really quality for you. 10 out of 10 props for Billy, you know what I mean, accommodating Scottish wrestling, like, nobody else.
No bother. For anyone who is curious, I'm not doing this during work hours. That is definitely not happening. Is my lunch hour instead. But no, I'm glad to have you on. Yeah, like we were going through when I was asking for guests, or not asking for guests, but for suggestions anyway. And your name popped up a couple of times for getting you on the show. And I did ask you for to do it. Like I used to do on-site Q&As, and to be honest, they were great. The people that did them gave me great answers. I hated doing them because you don't get this. You don't get this interaction. I'm just asking you like 10 questions, and you could repeat every time each question. Oh, I like Eddie Guerrero, and then oh, who would you like to wrestle? Oh, Eddie Guerrero. That's boring. This is a bit more exciting because there's always a chance that I'll forget something and look like a right knob at the same time. So it's the added jeopardy of doing a podcast. But this, I think this is your proper first Scottish wrestling podcast. I think you did ESSR for 10 minutes. You did a couple other podcasts. This is your first proper Scottish wrestling podcast, I think.
I would say so, yeah. I think so. Yeah. Maybe I think I've done the ICW Fans podcast,
oh,
to be fair. I did come up to Amatus and Mary Hall for that. I remember that. This is the first time I'm working with the best Scottish wrestling podcast, you know what I mean?
Clip that. There we go. So we'll start with the basics then. The basic question which you ask every wrestler is, what got you to wrestling? So what was the moment that really you watched it and went, I'm watching wrestling. I love this forever.
Well, I can remember. I can't really remember much, but I always get told after my sister and my nana and that when I was growing up that we were in my uncle's house. It was my birthday, 19th of January, my birthday, so I would have just turned 3, and somebody had the Royal Rumble, and it was the next day. Probably know that even that day, but the week after, it would have been the week after or something, but I'm just saying, because it was on my birthday, I just remember that date being on my birthday, this Royal Rumble. It was when Shawn Michaels won the belt, and apparently my uncle had been watching it, or somebody had been watching. My cousins, in fact, I was at my cousin Terry, he'd been watching it in his room, and I was in the house, and I seen it, obviously, and I went up to the telly, and I've been like fixated on it, watching it, whatever. So then after that, I would watch it here and there, but I was never massive into it. I was just watching my cousins and stuff like that. My nana, my family never really came for, obviously, a rich background. And back then, to like, see wrestling, you kind of had to have like Sky or cable. There was other boxes. There was Sky and there was the other NTL Digital.
Oh, I was remembering on digital. That's why I remember.
That kind of thing. That was the only way you could watch it. We didn't have anything like that. We had channel 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. I remember one time I seen the Royal Rumble on channel 4, and sometimes you'd see WCW on channel 5 and stuff like that. But so, as I said, I would watch it here and there, but I wasn't big into it. But then it's a bit tragic, you know what I mean, when it gets to this. But when my mum died when I was 6 years old, obviously I was rather quite depressed, you know what I mean, obviously lost my mum at such a young age, didn't have a dad or anything like that, so I was really upset. I would just sit down the stairs. Like, we stayed in a close in Govan. So there was my nan up top with my uncle, and then I would stay downstairs with my mum. So when my mum passed away, I used to just like sit outside the door waiting on my mum to come back. Because I didn't really understand death, you know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. It's quite a sad story, you know what I mean? Even hanging over, you're like, oh, you know. But just, I used to, that was quite, obviously, my nan hated that, you know what I mean? But so then my nan noticed whenever I was in my cousin's house and I was watching wrestling. It was the only time that I wasn't really sad, you know what I mean? So then my nana changed, I just went body, you know what I mean? Bought every video she could. She went out, she was skint, she went and bought Sky TV. And it was in my room, it wasn't in the living room, you know what I mean? I had Sky in my own room when I was 6, 7 years old. She would buy me all the figures. She would let my cousins come around Xander, and she'd let Steg stay with me whenever, so we could all watch the wrestling. She'd let me stay after schools on Mondays, so I could stay up and watch the pay-per-views, just all the... Because the way my nana was obviously older than age, she'd had her 3 kids, and now she has to watch me and my sister. She could have let us go into care, but she wasn't going to do that. So I think she was just wanting an easy life, you know what I mean? It was like, I could obviously... Like, you know what I mean? Like, I could, because by the time, once she bought any, and obviously I've got ADHD, you know, so you kind of obsessed with some stuff, you know what I mean? So I get really obsessed with wrestling. So, I mean, that way, my nana, like, because she gave me it so much, like, if she stopped giving me it, I'd have probably got quite erratic and annoyed and all that. So she's just done everything for me. And obviously, as I said, it made her happy, obviously, you know, seeing me upset and that, obviously crying about my mum and stuff like that, because obviously, as I said, I could just only imagine that would be quite hard to take, especially now that I've got my own kid and that, you know what I mean? Stuff like that, obviously. You know, even just my own kid, just you've seen kids upset, it's not really a nice thing. So I'd imagine that would have broken my ass heart. So you just put all the things into wrestling. So that's how I get into wrestling. And then obviously, I was lucky that my cousin loved it, and Steg, my other pal. So thick as thieves, we'd just kick about Govan all the time, and we would do Linhouse. We would just walk about the streets of Linhouse, and we would find old mattresses that had been flung out, and we would take them to this one back garden that had a good wall to jump off of. And we'd wrestle in one, not I mean, but we'd always try and get like 2 or 3, so it was good, and it was like a ring. And we'd obviously, if you get a double mattress, it was better, obviously, because it was bigger. And then we used to wrestle 24/7 just to freeze for the crack of dawn, night time, man. Honestly, we actually used to get like people coming and watching us and stuff like that as well. But because the stuff we'd do, we'd like put each other through like cupboards and stuff like that, and we'd find like old weapons and make like old snooker tables and stuff. People thought we'd use anything that we could get to our disposal, and we would just batter each other. So that was all that was kind of my first. That's how I get into wrestling, and no weary to idea on a bigger stage, you know what I mean? So swapped it no bad.
So the Govan team was day one. It was always...
So obviously, especially people watching, if people have actually watched my career and stuff like that, you would think, oh, it's Ravie, and then I've maybe invited somebody along and then invited another person along, but it was me, Xander, and Steg for day one. And then as we got older, but when we got into high school, we all went to 3 different high schools. So obviously, just as that happened, we obviously still were piling with each other and that, but obviously you just tend to... kick about with the people that you'll be in high school doing, you know. I don't know if that's something that you've done, but I'm sure everybody in the world had a pal that they were pal in primary school that they didn't kick about with as much when they went to high school. So that was kind of me, Xander, Steg, still the best of pals. Anytime we would see each other, we'd obviously be like the best pals ever on that. But then eventually as well, I get kicked out of my school, so I end up back in school with Xander. So that obviously came back together. But as I said, we didn't like fall apart, and that was just obviously... And you get, plus at that age in all high school, that's when you kind of, you don't stop liking wrestling, being a kid on, that you don't like it anymore, you know what I mean? So you're like, but to be fair, I was always, I don't know, it sounds mad, but I used to always, like, I never gave a fuck, no, I mean, I've never gave a fuck. My mum passed when I was 6, and then I have a dad, no, I mean, like, what if I go to Los, no, I mean, like, except for just, like, just being myself, what if I go to be embarrassed about, what did I go, I don't care what other people think of me, all these kind of things, right? So I've just always, I always was more apologetic. So I've always did. People tell people I like wrestling and stuff like that, but I don't think Xander and I don't think Steg did and stuff like that. And even at that time, I wasn't still big into it. I started getting drinking, started getting buds and all that. So wrestling wasn't my main focus. But then once the WWE Network came about, I think that was 2012, was it? Maybe a bit.
Like that, yeah.
The WWE Network came back, and I was right back just watching all my old stuff, everything just fell back in love with. And then I started So what happened was my nana passed away. I don't imagine, but you've not even asked me this question, but I'm imagining the
It's
next
fine.
question probably is why did I end up becoming a wrestler? So I'm going to tell you
It
this anyway. So obviously I was 21 years old, so I started watching that again. Me and Xander Stegger watching it and stuff like that. It was actually Xander that helped, because we wanted to know it didn't launch in the UK for a while. Xander helped me get what's it called, a VPN, so I could watch it in Scotland, even though it wasn't out there yet. So I was watching all that stuff. So that's how I ended up seeing the Daniel Bryan WrestleMania and stuff. Not I was watching the WWE Network when it was even available in Scotland. But so as I was saying, I was watching that. My nana passed away. And it was the same time the ICW documentary came out, Insane Fight Club.
okay.
So I watched that. Obviously, I'm right back at wrestling again. But so I've got ADHD as well, as I said. So I'm back in the obsessive part of it. No, I mean, I loved wrestling again, because I found the WWE Network watching all my favourite stuff in the past, all that kind of stuff. So I was just mad for it. And I seen the documentary and I seen Grado and love the man a bit. It's done so much for my career. But see, when I first seen him, I was like, I am right. He's bigger than me and I'm funnier than him. Not I mean, see if he can do it. If he's the best at it, then I can be the best at this. Not I mean, so I'm going to go and try. I'm going to become a wrestler. And then the GPWA just no longer opened either. I'd seen an advert for it. And as this was happening as well, my nana's literally just passed away. She had cancer and stuff like that. So she'd passed away and she'd left me a certain amount of money. No, not in mental, not I mean, not wasn't rich after it, not I mean, it was just a wee whatever she had in her bank, it got split up between me and my sister and my two wee cousins. So I had £250 and the first course was £125 a day, 8 weeks in the asylum. So I used that money. I just thought to myself, it's something to be proud of me, not maybe beyond the grave. Sounds, there's people there like, talking shit, all hocus pocus, home, off the kill, pish, not I mean, but just something, we can date me when I'm proud of me beyond the grave. So I went and joined the wrestling school, GPWA, and obviously it's got to sound big here. For the day I went in there, I just felt like, this is it, this is what my calling is, not I mean. I was a fully qualified welder by then, and I hated every minute. Not I mean, everybody's like, you've got to make good money, not I've never been driven by money, not I mean. Money's no, I mean, makes me passionate. I want to be happy in life, not I mean. I lost my mum through depression, not I mean. Not going to go into details, but I'm sure you can put two and two together with that. Not I mean, maybe even read stuff before, but probably seen some of my sick jokes on TikTok, actually, but fuck no. But I'm sure you can put two together. So I don't really care about money, not I mean, what happened? See all the money you save up and you make and stuff like what's happening when you die. You can leave it to somebody fair enough, not I mean, but you'll know it doesn't matter. Money burns a hole in my pocket. But I just want to be happy in life, and ever since I started training to be a wrestler, I've been happy, not I mean, the depression and stuff like that's alleviated. Obviously, like, I've been wrestling for 8 years, so I can't say I've been, it's been all bumps, sunshine, and buttercups, and I've been happy and farting fucking rainbows the full time. But in the last 8 years, I've been more happy than I've been sad, not I mean, and through my full life, I've probably been more unhappy and depressed about stuff than I have been happy. And for the last 8 years, it's been the opposite of that. It's just been more happiness and everything just seems to. I'm just living up my dream. No, I mean, sometimes I just wake up and pinch myself because I think it's mad how far I've got in life just through something that I love so much.
I'm just worried that you know the format of our show already, and it's only been 10 minutes.
No, I just like talking about myself, mate, honestly. No, I mean, this is a story that has been everywhere. People obviously like stalk me in the streets and stuff like that and ask for like, pictures, not why I talk to me and that. And I think after about 10 minutes, they end up regretting it because I end up talking about myself so much. Not I mean, I'm like, oh, this is how this. And they're like, oh, fucking hell, I'll have you somewhere to go, mate.
That's all right. It's absolutely fine for this kind of format, because yeah. I mean, when it comes to doing podcasts and that, there's not that many questions you can ask wrestlers that haven't already been asked before. Oh, we do have a couple of stupid questions we do ask people, which we'll get to. But so GPWA started. Of course, you did your backyard in with the rest of the Govan team. So, was there any immediate differences you noticed as soon as you went into the GPWA induction?
Well, the backyarding we done it, wasn't it? Like, I know of it, well, technically, it definitely is backyarding, but we stoked it. Like, see, most people that done backyarding, they probably did it when they were like 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. We were doing it like 7, 8, 9, 10, and then we probably stoked because we were getting a bit too big for it. You know what I mean? It was like, Oh, starting to obviously get attracted to the birds and that, and obviously starting to fancy, but you know that stuff. All the bigger ones are coming, but then I go to a stage and all where people are coming in and sabotaging. But we're doing that as well. You know what I mean? Just by that. So we stoked by the time that probably a lot of people were starting in the backyard. And so, but the thing is, I would say is it sounds mad. Obviously, I wasn't taking bumps in that when I was doing the matches. Well, I technically was taking bumps, but I'm no. Well, neck tucked up, my chin tucked, all that kind of stuff. You know what I mean? I was just getting flung at my pals, and I was flinging them. But no, there's a lot of stuff that actually was really similar. It's just you're learning how to land it and date safely and stuff like that in wrestling, which I did find kind of mental. Obviously, because backyarding is obviously so frowned upon, but yet it's not really much different except for one's a paying ticketed audience with a lot of people there, and then they'll just cut on mates out the back garden and have a laugh.
So were you always Ravie Davie? Was that always the character? Was that always, did it just evolve from there, or did you have something, I don't know, outlandish mental that you used
Well,
instead?
not so I've always been Ravie Davie, me myself, right? I've always been Ravie Davie since I was a wee boy. But when I wrestled, I was not Ravie Davie, and I didn't want to be Ravie Davie when I became a wrestler. Obviously, because I thought as a wrestler, you need to make your own character. You can't just come in as you. So I was Ravie Davie. So I couldn't come in and be Ravie Davie. You get me? That was my thinking. That was my thought process for it. So I wanted to be Callum Davidson, the Superior Scotsman. I would do a move called Unholy on that, because obviously Christian had done pretty. I'd have a move, but I'd have your legs right up there, basically kind of have you up like a jackhammer, but I'd just look ramp DDT, you know what I mean? So you couldn't really protect yourself around that. Obviously, I was doing it to my pals on mattresses, so I wasn't killing them around that, but it was definitely no what you would call Ravie Davie the day. I've got none there. So I basically, obviously, I pitched Callum Davidson to Wolfgang. I said, this is my idea for wrestling. He's like, that's shite. I was like, what do you mean, mate? I was like, I've been thinking this all my life. You know what I mean? This is my heart and soul, my wrestling. He's like, why do you want to just be Ravie Davie? I was like, what do you mean? He's like, well, Ravie Davie's a character, isn't he? And I was like, I mean, I am, like, people do call me a character, and I, when, you know what I mean, when I do meet people, like, you know, he's a character, him and all that, but look, like, I'm Ravie Davie, not me, I can't be Ravie Davie. He's like, well, you can, because you're David McCallum, not when you're obviously not actually Ravie Davie, you're David McCallum, so you can be Ravie Davie, and maybe just turn it up a bit. And I was like, all right, that sounds good to be fair, like, and it's going to be easier for you now, because you don't need to think, what would Callum Davidson do in this situation? You'd be like, what would Ravie Davie do in this situation? But you are Ravie Davie, so you don't need to think, what would Davie, you just say, what would I do in this situation? And obviously, then I go and do it, or I try and portray it in a wrestling sense. So that's where that came from. But no, I thought I was never to be Ravie Davie, so I'd technically be practicing to be Ravie Davie all my life, but I didn't think I'd be able to be as a wrestler. And then obviously, I know, when you're growing up in that as well, like, obviously, you always wanted to be a wrestler, but there was never really a path to do it. So, like, it's just that, you know what I mean? Like, so it was like a lot of people, I imagine, growing up in America when they were younger than that, they probably have. Well, there's people that definitely haven't known. There's even people that were my age probably had it themselves. But I just didn't think, even though that's what I wanted to be, I didn't have like everything pure, meticulously thought out and all that. You get me? Just went out and wrestled with my pals and thought it would be brilliant if there was like a wrestling youth club that taught us how to wrestle. We used to always ask youth workers that, you know what I mean? That's one of the reasons I'm pure proud of the school, because like, now I'm giving people something that's all I wanted. You know what I mean? Like, when anybody would come at me and Zander and Steg, but wrestling, wrestling, wrestling. The people would think we were talking about like freestyling, and like, no, we're talking about WWE, you know what I mean? Like a wrestling club. We can just fling each other about wrestling.
That's what I was about to say. As soon as you said that, the youth center thing. So pretty much, you've put your kind of your life into wrestling, and now you're just doing all you're providing all things that you wanted as a youth, to your community now, which is pretty commendable when you come to think of it as well.
It was not just my community, to be fair, but all right, it's so no, I've been doing wrestling for 8 years, right? And this is no dig to anybody, this isn't me calling anybody doing it like that, right? But I quit a really good paying job as a welder to become a wrestler, no, but that. Because I was hurting myself in the welding, and I was like, this isn't for me, I want to be a wrestler, so I don't want to hurt myself in the welding, I need to take so many weeks off, right? So I was just jumping about jobs and all that, and this, there was never really, the end goal was always to hopefully make enough money after this. It might never have happened, but it's just, that's what I was working towards. There's obviously a lot of wrestling, I'm not saying, because I think a lot of people play wrestling, I'm not saying that about anybody, you know what I mean? Everybody that wrestles and that, we're putting our lives on the line and that. So anybody who does it, they're a wrestler, you know what I mean? But I'm just saying, like, probably people that just, there is people that don't mind where it goes, they just want ideas and that. But for me, it was just that, always, like, I never really thought I'd make it to WWE either, but you know what I mean? Like, I've got things that might no help me get to certain places. I'm going to leave that for if I ever end up the James English podcast or something, or Joe Rogan or something like that, mate. You know what I mean? No offense to it, like that, but come on, I don't want to market my brand. But no, but as I said, so there was, it's always been, but I've always wanted to, like, make this my living. That's always just what I've been building towards. I wanted to have a company, I wanted to have a school, I wanted to wrestle myself and stuff like that. And now it's finally, after 8 years, just starting to kind of reap its rewards. I'm not quite where I want to be yet. It's a lot of hard work, but I've never been happier in my life. Like I said a minute ago, my missus was saying, my partner Georgia, who obviously helped me run everything, she was saying that she was up for a Mother's Day dinner yesterday and that, but obviously she ended up with her uncle's not there for her granny and stuff like that. And they were talking, end up that the topic came up about me, and that's what she was saying. She's like, she's never seen me so happy. And then that's what they would all end up saying, is like, it's because he's just never really wanted to work a normal job. He's always just wanted to be wrestling, wrestling, wrestling. Not even now, as I said, because everything is starting to get to that stage. But that's why I started the school, as I said, to try and make a full-time living. But see, now if I never made a single, like if I went into this school every week and I never made a single bit of profit again, I would still do it. Not, I mean, it's the most rewarding thing I've ever done in my life. It is. So I've got about, no, every weekend, so every weekend I have at least 45 to 50 kids in all different classes, and then I have my adult class, which is about up to, can be anything from 5 to up to 20 sometimes, but no in the one class. I've not had 20 in the one adult class, but I mean, the other 2 days, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So sometimes you're having 75 people come in through the doors, you know what I mean? We've only been open since October. And as I said, I would happily do it for nothing, you know what I mean? Just because how rewarding I'm seeing it is. It's like some of these kids have come into me and they're shy, they don't have any confidence, they're not really social, you know what I mean? Just being stuck on the computers and stuff like that. And see now, like obviously they've been coming for weeks now. They're all wee pals, they all have inside jokes and all that, they all band me up, not that shout daft to me, not when I'm getting them to Davy drills and stuff like that. The older class, the 12 to 15 year old class as well, they used to just stall and they weren't going to talk to each other and look at each other. Now if I turn my back, they've got themselves in heat blokes and all that and try to like, obviously work punch each other and all that. I'm like, oh, this is madness, you know what I mean? But it is honestly, it's the greatest thing I've ever done in life. And the way I see it is, right, obviously, everybody's got their opinion on what I'm doing, and I think because it's me, I get a lot more heat for the stuff that I do, just because I'm not your conventional guy. I didn't come in and do it the way that it's formulated. I come in, I got popular on social media, I used that to get myself on a lot of shows because I sold tickets and stuff like that. And a lot of people don't like that, but that's what happened. And now I think a lot of people expect me to pay even more dues before I do it. But the way I see it is, you can't. But if you wait about for stuff, the momentum might not be there. I don't even know where I've ended up going. It's always this and looks like ADHD. Sorry. The momentum could end up stopping and stuff like that. You know what I mean? So obviously, there's a lot of people that aren't happy the way I've conventionally done it. That's what I remember, conventionally done it, right? So obviously not happy to me. If other people would do it, whatever, it'd probably be a different story. But I just think, right, see if you're 5 years old and you want to be a boxer, see if you're 5 years old, you want to be a football player. If you're 5 years old, you want to be a gymnastics or and whatever else. You want to do anything, right? There's a club out there for you. But see if you're 5 years old in Glasgow and you want to be a wrestler, can you do it? Never do it. You have to, and this isn't about, right, and this is, because actually this is, in fact, this is me, you know, shout out, you know what I mean? Because this is one of the best places to go my ideas for. But obviously the only place you could go and date was FPWA. And if you're from Glasgow, driving to Fife, take your kid to this, and couldn't it, mate, I don't know if I don't check out other times and stuff like that, but it might not be, what's the words,
cost effective,
not even close. It might not be doable with the time you finish work, drive, all that kind
as
of stuff,
well, yeah.
all these different things. So I've got history as being a youth worker. I'm a trained youth worker. I have my own kid. I've been wrestling for 8 years. That stuff is, I've run like youth clubs and stuff like that. I've been part, I've done all these different things. So I just feel like all my skills that I have to get when I'm at the shows, I'm on, like, I know it sounds daft, not me, but like, I'm popular on TikTok, you know what I mean? So what do kids all love? Right now they all love TikTok as well, so I thought that would be a good part as well. Just all these different things that just made me what to do. Plus as well, one of the biggest things about it as well, my kid wants to be a wrestler, and there's nowhere for him to train to be a wrestler, so what was I going to do? Get a wrestling school opened for him to be able to train, and obviously through as well, he's got another pals and all that now. He's got another wee pals that likes wrestling that made him actually look up to him, because he's basically Shane McMahon, you know what I mean? He gets, like, obviously, like, that's probably not, people would definitely think I'm big he's saying that, but you get what I mean, and he's obviously the one that's, like, he's not, because, like, all the stuff I'm teaching these Wains, I've taught him 45 times, you know what I mean, before I even hit a wrestling ring or anything like that. So they're kind of all the reasons that I've done it, but as I said, no, it's the most rewarding thing I've ever done, and if I never make another penny off it, I'll still be running that wrestling school until the day I die.
Well, we'll say what I've kind of gathered from what we've talked about already was, at least with you having set up your own school, your own promotion, and be able to do that, you've regained control of it. Because I suppose when you started watching wrestling, it was a very spiraling time of your life, and you didn't have a lot of kind of control and a hold of things. And then you said you had your troubles in school as well, and there was not a lot of control there. Whereas now you're in charge. You've got your school, you've got your promotion, you've got your you're able to be in charge of something that you find ridiculously rewarding at the same time. So it just seems to be like you've went through the hard times to reap the benefits now, and being able to do what you want to do while you still can.
I mean, that's actually a really lovely put, the way you actually put that there. Not, I mean, I've never really thought about it that way, but I suppose I started watching wrestling because my life was absolutely fucked, you know what I mean? And now it has brought copious amounts of joy, you know what I mean? Like, any time, like, now, as I said, now my work schedule is, like, completely different, but any time I'm going to work, which is running the wrestling school, I'm buzzing, you know what I mean? I don't know if you've had, because you were saying earlier, you know, the best of job, or it's just a normal, whatever your job is, you know what I mean? I'm not going to disclose it, I remember what you said, I just thought I'd disclose it one day.
Okay.
Anyway, but, well, I don't know if you ever, have you ever woke up and been like, you ask how to go to work today?
No.
honestly, mate, it's an amazing feeling. It sounds mad, not, I mean, but see, waking up and you're like, oh, we've got work today. Oh, brilliant, can't wait. It's mental, not, I mean, it's that actually is a mad thing, because working is something that you need to do in life. And I feel like for the last 7 years I've been technically running away from it, because obviously, like, any time I got offered, if I'm working a job, I was working a job and I got offered a wrestling booking, I would tell them, oh, I've got this booking for wrestling, I can't work this day, and most of the time, but you can't take that day off. I was like, I'm not asking for half. I'm telling you, I want to be a wrestler. I don't want to be a labourer in a building, because obviously, because I went back to the building, but I was never got a day. You know, I'm quite stubborn that way, you know. So I was never anything I was got a day. So I was just like telling them I'm got this job. So I had some amount of jobs through wrestling as well. You know what I mean? It was never. It just at some points I never feel like it would pay off. So just ground and ground and ground. And now, as I said, I know the hard times, there's going to still probably be hard times ahead, but it feels like I messed the hard times over, so you're right, mate. Lovely put.
Right. Professionalism, that's what we get here. So when it comes to your brand then, you mentioned that, I think that's a pretty good thing to go on. Talk about TikTok, of course. For TikTok, you were doing, there was stories popping up in various newspapers online of things of your shenanigans, so to speak, as well. So how do you do that, really? How's it like just going, how have you found the, I don't know, the recipe to go viral?
There's no recipe, that's the hard thing about it, but there genuinely isn't it. Obviously you can kind of, but like, I kind of, there's kind of a formula of it, know what I mean, like, get people talking, do something that's going to get people talking, sharing it, all the kind of things, but I swear to God, see the amount of times I've done a video and I thought to myself, this is it. This is the video. I'm going to post this and I'm going to be on the telly in America next week, not, I mean, doing interviews, not, this is the coolest video. And then you post it and you get 500 views, not, I mean, you're like, what the fuck? And then there's videos that you just do. You post it, you don't pick your phone up for another half an hour because you think, you don't, you know what I mean? You don't even think anything about the video, you know what I mean? You're just not even paying attention. You check back and you get a million views. You're like, what the fuck? You know what I mean? There's like no rhyme or reason to any, but obviously, like, for example, the sneak net, like the Amsterdam thing, I didn't think anything about that. I just thought, that was me explaining why I wouldn't be at an ICW on the Sunday, because I had just started getting my character in ICW, and in my stupid head, I thought people cared about this wee promo segment I was getting, not even on the show, with my videos in the fans, not in the Raven Report. I think I used to, I don't know if you remember it, but I used to think that was why, because Dallas had gave me this story. I thought in my head, this is the most important thing ever, so I need to explain why I'm no there this weekend, know what I mean? So I made up a story how I woke up drunk in Amsterdam because I was going on holiday there, and then before we know, I'm on CNN in Greece and Australia and all that, know what I mean? Having to talk about how I woke up in Amsterdam and having to kid on that I was drunk in Glasgow and woke up in another country. Obviously, that is my first ever, that's technically my first ever work, you know what I mean? But I've obviously made people believe, worked myself into a shit, brother. I mean, and I have to tell people that it was true, because obviously the amount of media attention go. So, as I said, there's not really a formula, but like, there's some things that you do kind of, you can kind of tell was going well. I knew the Rotten Food reviews, I knew they were going to be good. I just knew that. That's the first time I've ever kind of studied Edinburgh. I was just, but I was doing good on TikTok with my videos, and I was just like me arguing with people back and forth. But a lot of them, because they couldn't handle what I was saying to them, they would report my video and I'd get banned and stuff like that. And I was enjoying TikTok and I was growing on it. I had like 10,000 followers and stuff. So I was like that, and I don't want to get banned anymore, so I need to think of something. So I started watching TikTok more. And I was noting the best videos were the food reviews, Gordon Ramsay's slaughtering people's food, all the people, all the videos where I was arguing people, or where other people were arguing people. So I was like, can I put that all together? And I thought, Ravie's rotten food reviews, I'll go to places that are disgusting. Everybody does food reviews, does nice ones. Unless you're Gordon Ramsay, who goes to the lads, like, well, I can be like Gordon Ramsay, like, but on the street level. So I'm going to go to Rotten. And I remember the best kebab had done, that they had went viral years ago because people were giving them bad reviews, and they were replying to people at you're only saying this because I shagged your mom or that. And the guy was like heavy gone into town on people that were slaughtering the restaurant. So I was like, I'm going to go back there and see if it's still rotten. And obviously, you've seen, I'd imagine you've seen the video, anyway, best kebab one. So then that just, but that was a game, I thought it would do good, right? But also, I was just coming, like, the only reason I put it, because I had an idea in my head, no, I was like, I'm going to pure film them all and do them all one by one and put. But then that same night, I'd made a backup, I had two TikToks playing and I had a backup one. I get banned on my main account again. And I was like, you know what, fuck this. And I was getting back away for the GPWA and I'd seen Best Club. I was like, I'm just going to go in and film this now, fuck it. And I just filmed it there and I was angry and I just posted it. And I walked out to McDonald's and I checked my phone and it was only 20 minutes later and I had like 10,000 views. And I was like, whoa, wait a minute, that's different, you know what I mean? Like, usually in 20 minutes you get, like, if you're lucky, 100 views, you know what I mean? I was like, that's no normal. And then I woke up the next day and it was like 300,000 or something like that, you know what I mean? I was like, whoa. I was like, shit, sweat, real. And then obviously the papers were on contact with me, isn't that? And then I just became a TikTok girl and I was just fucking filming everything and doing everything. Because that was my backup account, but I ended up, because of that one video, in one night I get 12,000 followers. I had more followers on my backup account than my main account. And obviously my main account had all my bans and all my threats are getting banned and stuff like that. So I was like, well, I may as well just start on this account. Just this is my account going forward. So that's my actual main account, is technically my backup, but because it's getting more followers. Obviously, it's my main. Sorry, I cut in there. As I said, there's no rhyme or reason for it. If you do a video and you think it's going to be good, there's a good chance it's got to do shite. But if you really work and you do your studying that, you might be able to find a wee formula or something and it'll work.
That's it. When I do my interviews and that, sometimes it like goes really well in the audio or the video, and I'm like, this is the one. This is the one. And then I put it up and it's like 30 views. I'm like, oh, come on. This is some of my best work here. So it's just, yeah. And then the next one, I'm like, oh, this is one I didn't do a lot of notes on. I didn't really prepare. And it gets like a couple hundred. I'm like, this just doesn't make sense.
It's definitely, honestly, it's the most, it's, see with stuff where you're, it's a passion of yourself, and that you obviously would do it regardless anyway. I feel like it doesn't rhyme or reason to it, you know what I mean? TikTok now as well. TikTok is now, I feel like with TikTok as well, I'd finally figured TikTok fall out. Every video I was doing were just smashing it there, and now they've changed their algorithm because they're trying to be like YouTube, so they want longer videos, they want you to put effort into it and all that. I've not got time for effort. One of the good things about TikTok was I could just fucking go stupid wee video, post it, put it away, and like, oh man, I've got 50,000 views on that, brilliant. You know what I mean? So fucking shoot me.
But speaking of the brand as well, was there anything like of course you watched the same Fight Club documentary which had Grado in it, and you said, oh, I'm funnier than him and I'm smaller than him, I'll do better. But was there any, but there's a lot of similarities to what how your branding goes with how Grado started as well. Was that just coincidence?
Well,
Was
obviously, no,
that
I did look up to, obviously, I did kind of look up to Grado on that, and he was obviously, he was the blueprint of how you can kind of make a living out of doing it. So, obviously, when he started, he was obviously trying to get his name out of doing all the videos, and, but obviously, I had to kind of take a different route. So, also, when I started wrestling as well, I also realised that not a lot of people like wrestling, right? Not that they don't like it, right, but they've stopped giving it a chance, right? My big thing about wrestling is, I think wrestling's like Santa Claus, right? What happens when you're younger and you find out Santa Claus is not real? You start going and telling everybody else Santa's not real, don't you? You start trying to ruin it for other people. It's the same thing with wrestling. That's why people are pure like, you know what, it's fake, right, don't you? Because it's the Santa Claus effect. They want to ruin it. But see, but you need to, we're not designed to be arseholes, right? So see, when we get older and we see kids enjoying Santa and all that, it goes away, you know what I mean? You start lying. Like when you're 20, if you've got a wee bra, stuff like that, when you're a certain age, you won't ruin it for them. If you're a bit younger, you might ruin it for them. There's a certain age where you realise, oh, no, I mean, you want to be pure, not, but nobody does it with wrestling, but no, I mean, they all want to still be arseholes with wrestling, so nobody ever really gives it a chance. So my big thing about wrestling is, see if I can get you in the door, I ain't gonna come back. I really do, especially if you used to like it. See, if you used to like it, you're gonna come back and you're gonna remember all your fucking memories about Stone Cold beating The Rock and fucking Shawn Michaels beating Bret Hart, all these kind of things. No, I mean, you're gonna remember all your favourite memories of wrestling if you come and see your shows, but you feel lied to, you feel betrayed, no, I mean, you feel what. You're hurt because it was once your favourite thing ever, and you even fought for it when people started telling you it was fake at first. You're like, no, it's real, you know what I mean? You're going to die, you're willing to die in that hell at first, and then you finally realise, you're like, oh, you see that punch or that kick that maybe doesn't land, or you see somebody like Rey Mysterio beating The Big Show, you know what I mean? You see something that's doesn't quite add up, and you're like, oh, no, and you're disappointed, you know what I mean? So my thing about wrestling is, you need to get in the door. So my big thing as well was, I know I'm funny, right? I know, right? I didn't used to think I was funny. I used to be quite, when people would tell me I'm funny and stuff like that, I'd be like, I like me, but eventually you kind of get told you're something so many times, and then you need to eventually believe it. So now I don't know what, I've got a track record of being funny. People have paid into a gig to see me beat all these kind of things. I've got a track. So I know I'm funny, right? But I also knew that I was going to, like, no, but I feel I'm at a decent standard there. It's not like I'm one of the best in Scotland, obviously, you know what I mean? But if I say that, I'll obviously get all the purists, not dissecting every day. But wrestling's a full package, you know what I mean? It's not just about your in-ring, it's about your brand, what you can talk on the mic, what you can do, all these different things, how you connect with the audience. But so if I say I'm one of the best wrestlers, people might shit on it. But anyway, where was I going with that? Oh, ADHD, mate, sorry about this.
It's all right then. Yeah, I kind of just was so enthralled I forgot why you
I'll
even
remember
asked
it,
in the first place.
I'll
That's fine.
remember it, I'll remember it, I'll remember it, I'll
It's not about using your brand. Getting folk in the
Oh,
door.
I know, that's what I was going to say. So obviously, I know I'm funny, so I thought, to get people to come and see me, I'll do what I've always done, because before I went into wrestling, I did actually have some viral videos and all. My whole I'm on the night shift video, I don't know if you've ever seen that, but that was just something that went viral. Done a lot of kind of videos before I was ever into wrestling, so I always knew that being funny makes people like you, makes people want to see you, wants to talk to you, all these kind of things. So I just thought, as a wrestler, I'm just going to be funny, I'm just going to do all my videos, try and be as funny as I can, and try and get people in the door. That is kind of what my brand is. I'd say my brand is that people obviously say my character is technically an egg, but I'd say I'm more the lovable rogue. Everybody knows a Ravie Davie, you know what I mean? Like, everybody's got a Ravie Davie around the corner. No, I mean, everybody's got a Ravie Davie that stays around the corner, that guy that's trying to sell them for something for £40, no, I mean, just try to obviously get them, he's always up to something, no, I mean, there's no, It might be no good, but it's no something that we're all too concerned about. Nothing, just all of these different cases. So that's what I've always gone for. I'm going for the lovable character who's funny, not being able to get stoned, but obviously you wouldn't want to leave them. You wouldn't leave them to watch your house, not in case you come back and it's trash, that kind of thing. So that's what I've always been kind of trying to portray, and that's what I feel like being funny is one of the biggest reasons my brand is so good. Obviously, doing stuff like I follow Gradle, the blueprint, and that, and go ideas for the Insane Fight Club, because they do the bit where they try and obviously they try and go viral themselves and stuff like that. Then obviously as I go viral, I started to kind of get the formula. You always want people comment and stuff like that. Shop value is always good. So I feel like my brand has been, it's hard, because obviously my brand is really Scottish, you know what I mean? Like I feel like if other wrestlers in the UK had bought a brand as well as I have, they would probably be wrestling in like America and maybe in Japan and stuff like that and getting flown all over Europe. But mine's obviously quite Scottish heavy, but I don't think it would be as big if it wasn't Scottish, you know what I mean? So it's a catch 22 for myself, obviously, because if I'd never done this, I wouldn't be as big. You know what I mean? But if I feel like, if, let's say, I'm just saying, for example, say, for example, Fyodoros had over 250,000 followers, I believe he would be like in America, some technology, you know, these things, or because obviously, or even your Jason Reed's, or not, I mean, like people, but just because there's this, I know Jason Reed's technically is Scottish centred, but you can put that anywhere, you know what I mean? You just, he's the sports fan of the most. The biggest, like he goes to America, he's a Dallas Cowboys fan, you know what I mean? Kind of, that kind of thing. Obviously, I'm an LA Lakers fan, Boston, so, you know what I mean? He probably might be a Boston Celtics fan, but you know what I mean? You get what I'm saying, but whereas I
What you
feel
mean, yeah.
mine.
The language barrier, so to speak, it's like Jason, we're not gonna pick on Jason Reed for this particular bit, but for him, he's got like the physique, but he's also quite well spoken. He's not
Ah, exactly.
Scottish Scottish kind of thing. He's kind of got that.
Well, Leighton Buzzard, he is obviously already starting to go and do bits and pieces, but imagine if he had over 250,000 followers, he would have a contract right now, either with WWE or AEW or New Japan, you know what I mean? So, like, even other people, not, you know, who else is my part? Even somebody who I don't like, Thatcher, right? I feel like if he had something like 250,000 followers, he would probably be sent to the company or something like that, you know what I mean? But it's just, as I say, that I'm very Scottish centric, but that's my aim. Fault, but it's no, it's a catch 22, as I always say, and that's no me. I'm not making digs at anybody else, you know what I mean? I'm just saying, I'm actually saying, I would like to see these boys all have the following that I've got, you know what I mean? Obviously, I would love it. I want, that's the one thing I want, especially now. I just want to see everybody doing well in Scottish wrestling, obviously, except for certain things, but we're not going into that today, you know what I mean? But you obviously know what I mean, don't you?
I think I know, yes, I. Yeah, we don't want to sign up to that kind of thing. But that's it. You're talking about, I mean, it's not impossible because we've seen things like people go viral in the US, like the boy with the pizza who did the pizza gimmick and that, and he ended up on AEW. So it's not impossible to say if AEW came to the UK, they want to get some of the viral stars on their show. That's not to say that they wouldn't go, this guy's got 250,000 followers, we're going to get him on show. So
Well, obviously, when AEW come to Scotland, they'll be saying to Xander, hit up your good pal, Yuta Wheeler, because Xander and Yuta Wheeler are somehow pals and in a group chat and all that each other. I'll be saying, Xander, get him, send all the my socials and all that, tell them to show Big Tony K, and then obviously try and get me on to do a wee job spot against Wardlow or something like that. I mean, I could definitely take a full bomb something, you know what I mean?
Maybe Davey, John Boxley. That's it. Book it.
Yeah, I know.
So we won't totally focus on the brand because it is like this is what kind of what I do the podcast for. Why I have the website is I always try to promote the live experience because that's it. I've getting them in the door and the memories start to flood back. I mean, not so much like I got my wife to her first wrestling show and she was like, okay, I get why you go to these shows. I'm not going to watch it on TV, but I get why you go to them because it is just an absolute riot for 2, 3 hours. So the live experience is the best thing about wrestling personally, whether it's funny or wrestling centric or something serious or what have you. It's a circus, it's a variety show, and that's what yourself and Community Pro Wrestling seem to really push forward because you do have the wrestlers doing the wrestling. We've also got the characters doing the over the top stuff as well. So it's a nice mix, a variety of what wrestling should be.
Well, I know, I appreciate you saying that because that's what I see wrestling as, right? I'm not gonna lie, I'm not gonna pure dick, but there's definitely types of wrestling that you can probably tell by my style that I'm not into. But just because I'm not into it doesn't mean that Other people, and there's wrestling fans that love all wrestling, and there's people that like the wrestling that I don't like. We probably don't like the stuff that I like and stuff like that. So, especially when you, when I was as a wrestler, I still would like obviously to be on cards where it's like a variety show and stuff, can everybody's doing something different. But with my own shows, I definitely try and portray it like that. Obviously, my favourite wrestling is like WWE and the Attitude Era, or the Ruthless Aggression Era, or like TNA in between like 2002 and 2006. I like wrestling where it is. But I'm at, like, there's everything. You know what I mean? They've got the segments, they've got the wrestlers, they've got the main event talent, or main event talent, they've got the big guys, they've got the wee guys, they've got the women, they've got everything. No, I mean, I like that's the wrestling that I like. I don't want to just, but it's obviously for my ADHD brain and all. I mean, I couldn't sit and watch a show if it's just all the same stuff. I would be on my phone or talking to people. No, I mean, that kind of stuff. Whereas if it's a show that's constantly changing, different characters, all this stuff, then if that's what it draws me to it, I feel like I'm a big Wayne, you know what I mean? So that's what's going to drive like Wayne and stuff like that. I always remember one time and all when I was coming through in wrestling, like, we always just like, pitch stories and that for like certain shows, and people were like, oh, it's Wayne's shows, they don't really need stories and stuff like that, they don't go into stories, try to see wrestling. And I would just always think that is the biggest lot of shit I've ever heard in my life. Because when I was a Wayne, it was the stories that I cared about. I wasn't even fucking watching your 60-minute Matt Classics, you know what I mean? What the fuck, man? I was watching Stone Cold kind of me a beer truck and scooshing air people, Shawn Michaels, fucking the Montreal Screwjob, John Cena and the Ruthless Aggression, all that stuff. Not, and that was all the stuff that got me hooked to it. So obviously, as I said, so that's what, and I think other kids would be hooked to that as well. And see, now that I do, like, obviously I don't day pure. I'm not one of these guys that I'm going to day, I'm not going, because obviously I'm trying to run as many shows as I can. I'm not going to day a story and govern and then the next 2 weeks later and say if I'm in, well, we've got a show booked in Helensburgh for June. If I'm going to Helensburgh, I'm not going to then expect, even though I've got a lot of travelling fans, I'm not going to carry the story out of there. Not in effect, I'm going to do bold stories in venues. So if I know Bermuda's going to be staying, because like, that the first one, we sold that out, and the tickets gone for the second show are already flying out the door. So I'm going to now try and do like Bermuda-centric stories. I've got my Govan-centric stories. Eventually, once I start filming, which I'm filming wee shows here and there, but just it's all budget stuff, not, I mean, I would rather, I want my show to look, like, before I film all my shows, I'd rather have the setting look as good as it can before you present it. I think I've filmed some shows and they look all right, you know what I mean? But I just, before I'm filming every show, I want it to be perfect. Maybe not perfect, but I'm sure you get what I'm saying.
Okay, yeah, right. Well, so, you want to present it the best way you possibly can before.
Yeah, like, for example, if I get something to film it for three shows, I could use the money that I'm paying to film them towards eventually getting a better setup that knew that I'll be happy with. Just these kind of things. So that's my reasoning for it. It's always for the live audience, and it's the circus style I like, because everybody's different, nobody's got to be the same. One would be shite if we're the same. So if your wrestling shows all the same, then guess what? That's probably got to be shite or not.
When it comes to things like you say, you're branched out, you're Hillsborough, and you got Barmalick and Govan and all that. Like one of the more random ones is Peterhead, which was when I was looking at, when I saw you announced it, I was like, is there another Peterhead in Scotland? Because Peterhead's up my way. I'm like,
somebody just messaged me and because obviously I do another thing as well called Suplex Celebrations. I need to promote it, to be fair, but it's basically we do birthday parties in the hub. If you book your own wee show, the wrestlers will do three matches in the first half. It'll be like a skirmish, well, obviously it's not quite decided who's won. Then we have the cake. Bad, depending on if it's someone's when it, like, there's cake getting stole by someone, but so we have the bad guys come out, take the cake, good guys come out, challenge them to a match at the end of the night. Winner gets the cake, bad guys are like, right, no bother, but we'll take the cake now. Day the six man tag match, you get the win, buff the boy or buff the girl, we come in, hit the finish, pin them 1, 2, 3, so the Wayne's actually won the cake back, not, I mean, storytelling. Then obviously Wayne's celebrating, and if we've got a bit of time at the end, because it's located in the school, I'll let the Wayne's all hit moves on me so they can kind of get a feel for if they want to come along to the school and that as well. But advertisement at somebody's birthday, not another kid. So with that, a company for England, I've just been talking to a company for England, and it's like, how about, if anybody messages me and asks me about it in Northern England, I'll put them on to you and vice versa. And the guy messaged me and said, somebody from Peterhead messaged me, would you do a show there? I was like, I'll do a show anywhere as long as it's financially viable. And then the guy that got in contact with me basically says, like, it's a charity fundraiser, so it's not a full charity fundraiser, so it's like a 50-50 thing, like, we're gonna make a bit of money, but we're also gonna put a bit of money towards this. He's trying to make raise funds for a basketball team or something, Peter Heed or something like that, yeah, it's running it. So it's
Yeah.
kind of like it's like a half and half bought in show, half, no, I mean half and half, no. It's heavy stress and mute because of that, no, I mean, I did, I'd rather take full control or let that guy just bought fully in. I've, no, I mean, because obviously I'm new to this business and all, I'm no, so I thought, oh, this would be a good idea. But it's, so I'm going to go into the longs and things with it, but if I ever do it again, it'll be me that's doing it all myself, and I'll just come up and fly on post and that. But obviously, all these kind of things are hard because I don't drive. And so that was my idea. I was thinking, no, this guy says, why do it 50-50? It's like, cool, you advertise on post and that. But my advertising post, and I'm quite meticulous with it, I'll go and I'll put funnels, I'll get a lot of flyers, put them through people's letterboxes, and I put posters up. But people just normally put like four bits of sellotape on with their posters. I laminate my full poster with sellotape for one reason, but no, I think about it, right? See if your job is getting sent out, you see if you work for the council, you're getting sent out to rip in a poster anyway, you're going to be like, ah, fuck's sake, man. Is this really my job, right? So you're going to know what to do anyway, right? Then imagine you get to that poster and it's been fucking stuck on with like 20 bits of sellotape and you actually need to pure work to get out. You're going to be like, ah, fuck this. I'm not doing that. You know what I mean? And it works me because see the amount of times that now ones that used to get ripped off don't get ripped off anymore. It's mental, you know what I mean? So I'm quite meticulous, mate. I've not seen any bad thing about the guy who's done it. I'm sure he has worked hard and stuff like that, and he's done everything that he thinks is a good job, but it's just no, I would just have been up doing it as much as I could, you know what I mean? So it's gone well for ticket sales, you know what I mean? But also as well, I'm a bit greedy, every single one of my shows have sold out, and I think this is going to end the streak, the Peter Heath one. No, by too much, you know what I mean? But I'm just a greedy bastard. I've had nine shows sell out. My first nine shows I've ran, I've sold them all out, and I'm about to do my 10th with Durham Chapel. So it's just now, you're like, argh, bastard. You know what I mean?
So this is the big push then for the Peterhead show. That's if anybody, if anyone listens to this and's got anything they want to get to Peterhead show, or at least buy a ticket. You don't have to come, just buy a ticket.
No, you should come. No, you should come. But to be fair, because I do think, I actually did hang as well with Peter, because I was going to just do a one-up, but I think I probably will go back up because they were sort enough that I think we're building something up there as well. You know what I mean? It's just Peterhead's just a wee village, and not, there's not a lot of a wee turn up, whatever, not a lot. I don't imagine a lot happens. And that's one of the things I want to get to a lot of places like that, but not a lot of stuff happens because that's like a lot of people try to get themselves into big places and big cities. It's not you want places that not much happens, so that they take, doesn't matter, they don't care if they like the history or they just want to go in, then they go down to see the rest and they enjoy it. You get what I'm saying?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think for Peterhead as well, I think they had UPW there for a while. Yeah, United Pro and then Professional Zone run there
Why,
every
that's
so
actually,
often.
I did feel
So
bad to be fair because the guy that's brought it into me made it to me as if nobody runs it anymore, and he said people used to run it, so I thought maybe it wasn't financially viable or something like that. You know what I mean? I thought maybe it wasn't, so I should have done my due diligence and maybe I should ask, you know what I mean? But I never done that. I feel bad about it now. But
here we are.
stuff happens.
Yeah,
Here we are.
exactly.
Exactly. So my bad. But as I said, it's a learning business. Now I know what to do going forward. Anytime I've gone to a new place, I will make sure to message people and do my due diligence and all that kind of thing. And that's all you can do. You know what I mean? Obviously, as I said.
It's a learning curve, isn't it? Like you're saying, it's just a. I'm just realizing I'm looking at myself in the Zoom here. I look like one of the members of. I don't know if you remember what they called. Oh, they had Bilby Cannon in it for a bit. It's the red with the. The red berets and the green gear. Oh, it's going to come to me in a bit. I'm just looking at myself now, thinking I look fucking terrible in this particular outfit.
Red and
Anyway,
green should never be seen unless we're going to cut a washing machine, apparently.
oh well, I'm near a fashionista, unfortunately.
Oh, no, never mind. I only know that rhyme because people have said it to me for wearing red and green at the same time. You know what I mean, mate?
So when it comes to the divide, though, like. There's not a segue I was going with, but one of the videos, of course, came viral was someone driving past you, flying in or what have you in your Celtic inspired singlet. Was that another just conscious decision when it comes to like the Govan team? Of course, Xander comes out in the blue, you come out in the green and white. Was that just like a harmonious thing? Was that a conscious thought?
It was like that's the joke, you know what I mean? It's like because I my stepson's a Rangers fan and stuff like that, you know what I mean? So I'm no, I love Celtic a day, but and for 90 minutes when I say Rangers a game on a day, love the rivalry and the banter and that. But I'm no pure, I don't like, there's Celtic fans that and Rangers fans that like hate each other, not I mean don't even know each other, like just like, and I'm not into that, not I mean Xander's not into that either. So we kind of had the idea, let's get old from singlets and that, and well obviously for like, we're a team, not I mean, so obviously people think it's mad, but I think people that like, it's a way to like, if one, let's see, there's a team that just put two Celtic singlets, you're like, it's a way to get everybody, not only, it's a way to get everybody liking it, you know what I mean? That, plus, anyway, we were obviously, I know, it was when we were doing right good merch sales on the first Govan team t-shirt, we're like, well, let's get these out and we can then sell Celtic Rangers Govan team t-shirts. So, we never got around to doing that, to be fair, like, in COVID or something like that, and fucked us. But that was probably the main reason, to be fair, to sell merchandise, but it was one of the, also the other reason was because we were against the, or the shade that comes with being a team and we support different teams, but doesn't mean you're not a team. And I think there's a lot of people who are the complete opposite of that, aren't they?
For folk that are shouting at me, it's Truth Commission was what I was thinking of, the Truth Commission. Is Steg getting Partick here? Is that his going to be his?
He's so now we're getting matching Govan team trackies because if you go to singlets are outdated anyway, kind of thing, and. Steg obviously supports Celtic, so we can't have two as well on the Celtic trackie and one on the Rangers one, because then it will be back to that fucking divide thing that I was saying. It kind of only works when there is two, is not I mean, unless we get a fourth member, but then that's too much, not I mean, that's too many people getting into the merch cut, not I mean, fuck that. Fuck's sake, already about an audience of them to keep Steg some, not I mean, but to be fair, Steg's my good pal.
So we haven't really talked about a lot about your actual in-ring wrestling stuff, so we'll do a bit of that before we actually close up and I actually go back to work.
This is the bit where I'll freeze up and you'll not get me going on big long tangents. This is the stuff that they've never wants to talk about. Not I mean, everybody, like, all that stuff we went through the past, I spoke about that in all different kind of podcasts, whether it be wrestling ones that people who are like, my big mate 5-0 who's just getting on because he knows that I'm good at the TikTok, or like, you know what I mean, all the podcasts that I've done that aren't really wrestling audiences, that's kind of all the stories I tell. So this is when you're going and freezing up.
There was two opponents that really like I really wanted to talk about, or at least get your thoughts on, one being James Storm. Of course, had a Texas death match with him. Of course, being a fan of early TNA, of course, you would have seen James Storm. He would have been a guy that you would have seen a lot for America's Most Wanted and Beer Money. So what was it like actually meeting James Storm and getting to actually wrestle him?
It was actually James Storm who got me into TNA, the six-sided steel cage match where you know, the Skipper, does, no, I mean, the, that's yep, what
turning point.
But I'd been watching it before then, but that was when I came down. I'd been like, sticking with the wrestling channel. I'd have it when I was playing with wrestlers. But then once that spot happened, it was like, wrestlers doing. Yeah, this is fucking something to watch. So that was a really cool moment. That was just a really cool moment. I obviously getting to wrestle with somebody. I was trying to think of something different to like go. But it was just all went well, to be fair. I was thinking if there's maybe any insider stories about planning the match and that, but it was really good with me the full time. He was trying to get over. Obviously, a big proponent of him being so good with me is because I worked with Bram previously, and Bram had told him how good I was. I think a lot of times in wrestling, like young boys or trainees or people are in, like, if they're in with a big star like that, they'd maybe not take a liberty, but they'd be like, doing a bit of extra training, a bit of extra teaching and that, but they two always looked. I think, especially with Bram, the stuff I'd done with Bram was a wee bit mental, know what I mean? Well, the thing with my eye, I was telling him to like, keep going, not, and he was like, you sure? So I think I've earned his respect for that. So then he's told James Storm, and it'd be a Texas death match and that as well, I think, but and that was my idea, it was me pitched that to Daz. So I think that like, in the past, like, not known in the past, but like, if somebody suggested a match like that to somebody who is quite big in the wee teeny, I think the person in wrestling history would maybe lay it in, teach not who do you think you ought to challenge me to a match this kind of thing, but it was nothing like that. No, I mean, it was all love, or well, it was really good, put me over, obviously, even he won the match, but everybody was talking about all the different things, the spots with his tax and that, and then for stuff like that after it. So that's definitely my top five favourite matches that I've ever wrestled in. Definitely.
The other opponent I was going to ask was Bram, so you've answered that question pretty much. So
Bram was brilliant. See, that was my first ever time watching like, wrestling a big name, obviously. Well, I'd wrestled with like, people that became on to become big names, but that was my first time wrestling somebody where you're like, I'll probably know, the amount of bookings I get this year, I'll probably not make his wage that he's getting for this one match. Kind of things like that. Not really, just like this is, it was mad, but it was so good with me. It was, everybody already had these stories about how Bram's mental, and one time on an ICW tour before the show, we were all having a drink in a hotel, and like, he's trying to like, get wide, like, he's trying to obviously like, act like the vet on me and try to like give me your shoes. No, I was like, no, I'm not giving you my fucking shoes, you know what I mean? And then, like, obviously it was that way, he was like trying to pump me out, and I wouldn't take it. I was like, mate, I was like, I don't know who you think you're, not I mean, or who you think I'm on. But I was like, but I come from like a dodgy place and all, you know what I mean? Like stuff like, you're not taking my shoes, mate. If I go home, people find that I've had my shoes stole off, mate, it'll not be worth it for me, you know what I mean? These kind of things. So I think the fact that I don't even mean malicious, I think it's just like the old wrestling, fucking try to make somebody pay their dues and ribbon that, and just the fact that I said, no, mate, like, I would rather fight you than have you make fun. He's a big guy, and I think that's one he's respect, you know what I mean? Then obviously after that, I feel like we made some magic, to be fair. Not, I mean, I feel like some of the stuff we've done, we definitely blurred the lines of what's real and what's fake in wrestling. Not, I mean, I told him before it, he was obviously trying to go the hard way, and he told him, he's like, if you couldn't do it, Sam Barber's bust me open the eye before, if you can't do it, you're made a pussy, then you're a big pussy, because Sam Barber can do it and you can't. And he came backstage after that. Funny fact, after that spot, so I was actually made a loss that match, obviously the wedding segment, and Wolfgang called an audio, we told Dallas, and that, he's like, you can't have him losing, you know what I mean? Look at the size of his eyes, the fans are actively scared, not I mean, people are actually worried, because I said the thing about Charlotte Flair, not I mean, obviously people thought, well, I've just said that I've not actually had permission or anything like that. So we definitely blurred the lines, but I ended up winning, because so I got a big win and a big show, because I was just up for letting somebody beat the shit out of me. Not I mean, but as I said before, it, I used to do stuff like that when I was younger, not I mean, like stuff, you know, I used to go fight and sort of these kind of things, and just for the funny as well. So now that I was getting to do it on a stage in front of people, it wasn't, obviously people think it may be mad, but I just think it's art, isn't it?
It's, I mean, if you're willing to do it, I suppose, what's it's up to you. As long as you have kind of like, it's back to that control thing, as long as you have kind of a little bit of control, you knew it was going to happen.
I don't think. But I just think as well with all this stuff, but when wrestling, I feel like there's a lot of people who get into wrestling and like, they forget why they went into it. No, I mean, you get into wrestling because you loved it. No, I mean, wrestling's over maddest whatever. Like, imagine, say, you go, you're a boxer, you're an MMA or something like that, and you're sparring stuff like that, and people are showing submissions. I don't think anybody gets told, oh, they're going to get put in an armbar today, and they're like, yes, I did to me. We see in wrestling, we've seen you learn to be a wrestler. See if somebody says, oh, who wants to take a choke slam? There's hundreds of people, well, I'll take it, mate. No, I mean, or who wants to take a field driver? Oh, me, I'll. No, you know what I mean? It's the maddest thing in the world. And I feel like when a lot of wrestlers get into it, maybe they forget to say it because they don't want to take this, why do this, why do that. It's just, I don't know. Another tangent for me, but...
It's all right. So before we kind of wrap up then, we asked two questions. I don't know if you've seen any past episodes. We asked two questions to everyone. They're ridiculous questions. We've asked them to Big Demo, Grado, and everyone in between. So what would win a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
One cow.
I like the confidence in that answer. Fair enough. And the other question we ask everyone is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
My favourite dinosaur is... this is funny. I used to be mad at dinosaurs when I was a wee boy. I went missing, right? My man, my sister couldn't find us, how young I was, something when I was still alive. And I'd actually walked into the Pollock Centre, go to the wee woman that had the bookshop. And she used to always give me dinosaur books, and that's what I went to. I stayed in Paul, by the way, then walked for Govan all the way to Paul. So I went, at that age, it was probably like a 45 minute walk, to be fair, not I mean, but now it's probably about a 10, 15. So probably a. I've got a lot of, because I like a lot of dinosaurs. I mean, I'm trying to always know I've said that on it, but I can't like accept that. Tyrannosaurus Rex, I don't know. Stegosaurus, that's my grandmate called Stegosaurus, go for that.
There we go, that's fine. That's a nice one, that's a nice dinosaur. Great, well, I think there's so many things I probably could ask you, but we'll end up having our hour of tangents.
To be fair, I know you usually ask people to ask questions and stuff like that. We can just call this part one and I'll come back on next time. I get free time.
That's what we'll do. So before we go then, what do you want to plug? Plug whatever you want.
So we've got the wrestling school. We run classes on Saturdays and Sundays for 5 to 11 year olds, 12 to 15 year olds or adults. The timetables are all different, so you're probably better off messaging me. And on Wednesday we also run kids classes, 5 to 11 and 12 to 15. And we've got the wrestling company, we've got community pro wrestling, we're doing shows all over the place. So why don't you check us out, come and do one of your shows. We've got a show this Friday in Drumchapel, two tickets left for that, probably sold out by the time this goes out on air. Then we've got one 2 weeks after that in Peterhead. So if you are Billy should do a wee night out, not mean to Peterhead with all his pals, not head there to Peterhead for the wrestling. But anyway, if you are from that direction, please come and see us. It's going to be a belter of a show. I'm going to absolutely tear the house off the place because I thought it was actually a football stadium or wrestling. That's actually another reason I'm taking it. I took the because the guy told me football club and I thought we were wrestling in a stadium. So I'm going to blow the roof off the place so that it actually is like a stadium setting, you know what I mean? Then 2 weeks after that, we've got Johnston again. We sold out the first one in January after only putting the show out for 6 weeks. We literally booked it we had it 7 weeks to the show for the day I booked it, and we sold it in 4 weeks with 3 weeks to spare. So because of that, we've seen the demand go another one. So that's in April. Then a week after that, we've got Mount Vernon, and our company back in the day ran that place. We only sold 15 tickets to it. Right now we sold over 100 tickets to it. So it shows you that wrestling is booming right now again in Glasgow. It's a defunct promotion. Now, by the way, I'm on before anybody thinks so I'm stealing people's venues because I'm like that. Yeah, okay, man. Oops. That's a bad thing about my phone. Oh, no.
That's right. Yeah. I'm still here.
Right, sorted. No, but I was actually joking about that. Do you feel before everybody starts? You see, I say all those jokes, and then people don't know how to take me. I've probably got to get another seat for that there. But I don't give a fuck. Actually, I give a fuck, but not I mean, because I've fucking emotional issues. But anyway, right, tangent. Mount Vernon 20th. Then we've got the big one, right? Usually in Govan, we do the Fairfield Club. It's a title tournament. Every single show we've done, we've sold out, especially Fairfield Club. Every show has been to 440 people there. And after we sell it to 440 people, more people ask tickets. So what is the next logical step after that? Is get a bigger venue. So we're going to the Parkville Hub, which is actually where the wrestling school is. They've got a big, nice sports hall. We can hold 600 people. So we'll be crowning a champion. We have wrestlers that have never wrestled in Scotland before, such as Man Like Dries. Well, actually, he's the only wrestler who's not wrestled here before. But we've also got Simon Miller, who's not wrestled in Glasgow before, to be fair. Who guy with 300,000 YouTube subscribers, big in the wrestling community in that all over the world. And we have Adam Maxted, that's who I'm actually wrestling. And we'll be crowning a CPW champion. We've been doing all these shows and we've not got a champion yet, so that's what we need today. So I can gauge, you know, who the draw is, not put a belt on somebody and then say that's the person. No, I mean, if tickets, if it's not selling it after that, they're fired. Okay, man. We know what I'm going. And then after that, and all in June, we've got Dunmellington and Ayrshire, and then back to Bermuda, 9th of June, and then we've got Helensburgh on the 18th, and I booked day three all 1 week after each other because Billy basically said about how I was booking too many shows to keep up with, so I made it even harder for him. But no, seriously, what actually the reason I booked day three was because I had a goal to book 12 shows this year, and then I had realised that if I book day three shows in June, that'll be 12 before the first half of the year's done.
Right, and thank God I'm already bald because, yeah, if I had to try and organise 10 lot announcements that you put out in one go, I'm just going to just be bald. But, you know.
I'll give you two announcements that are booked in, but I've no any posts on that film. But we'll be having the first ever Community Pro Wrestling Rumble. It'll be called the Govan Rumble on the 25th of August in the Fairfield Club. And then we'll be having a 2-day anniversary show this year. Last year we only had one day. This year we'll be spreading out one day in the Fairfield Club, one day in the Hub. I'm going to try and get my first import for that show as well because I feel like that is also a logical next step. I've been talking with some decent names, but it's just not quite got there yet. So hopefully by then we will be getting somebody out for the States or something like that. That is the next two goals I've got for the company. Company's doing really well, but we can always expand, grow. The reason Blockbuster went out of business is because we just sat and took the business that we're doing. No, I mean, that's not what we're here to do. We're here to keep expanding, keep going forward. We're doing that. We're actually doing it with remember the old DCW thing, the and the Misfit Toys. That's what I feel with community pro wrestling is. It's guys that you're not going to really see all there, Scotland wrestling for. Or there's some guys that you will be no mainstays, not even my actual core talent, kind of exclusive to CPW. And that's not for any reason. That's just the way the cards have fallen. So promoters out there, I would actually wouldn't mind if you took some of my talent and put them on shows, because they sell a lot of tickets. I mean, it's not just down to me that my shows are selling out. It's because of the guys that I put on the shows working extremely hard as well. So please get in contact with them, get them on your shows as well, because it's not just about me, community pro wrestling. My missus does a lot, and so does the guys backstage, and that is why we're a big family. That's the reason I think we're being so successful. So this podcast is about me talking about myself, but I want to just finish it up by saying the most important actual part of community pro wrestling isn't me at all, it's the guys backstage that do the wrestling and the woman, the guys outside doing the crew, the woman doing the merch, who's one also one of them is my partner, and then obviously my partner for keeping me grounded and no booking 45 wrestlers a show, because I have definitely nearly done that at points in the past.
So you've got a Rumble coming up, but thank you very much for joining me today. We'll keep an eye on Community Pro Wrestling on your social media, and of course we'll put out the match announcements as soon as they go up. Quickly,
follow my TikTok, Ravie Davie Fresh Prince, and that's what's happening, troops.